So the new album, Little Brother Is Watching, fantastic album.
Thank you.
I'm really enjoying it. It's only been out for, I think, 4 days at this point, but day it came out,
four and a half.
Rolled over, picked up the phone, iTunes, there it was, and you know, started digesting.
Nice.
And it's, I'd say it's quite a departure from the last album, actually, because Abnormal's pretty intense. Playing-wise, I think the new album, it's got plenty of playing on it, but it's more song-based. You started playing in Argentina, right?
Yeah.
Which is a beautiful song. Like, the album is just full of songs.
It has more space. I don't want to say maturity.
Mm-hmm.
It has... it's not all... I don't think any of my albums were. It's just that I think what happens guitar-wise is you can play 20 melodies in a song, but that one moment that you do something fancy is what's going to stand out as you know, it's like, wow, what was that? And that almost takes the attention away from everything else.
Mm-hmm.
I think on the new album, there's so much more melody.
Yeah.
that it feels more balanced.
You are a guitar star, you're an icon, you're a technical guy, and you inspire a lot of people guitar-wise.
Cool.
But listening to the new album,
I've uninspired them.
Couldn't really think. There were a couple of points where I had to rewind and go, what was that guitar part? What I actually took away from the album was some great songs. So could you talk to us about the writing process, some of the influence behind some of the songs? Some of them are obvious, like Living the Dream, like the lyrics of that are pretty plain and obvious. But what about songs like Argentina? You played that for us.
You know, it's interesting. There were a lot of things that just... kind of hit like the reset button, the reboot button, the refresh while making this album. Like I was in South America, I went to a David Bowie exhibit, and just being there and seeing everything from his old wild wardrobe to just hand-drawn album covers where he's working on ideas. Mm. To seeing old videos and everything, and it just sort of zapped me back into where I was supposed to be. I was like, oh yeah, that's right, art.
Hmm.
You know, it's like you spend so much time on the road, you feel like a utility. And it's like, oh yeah, creativity. Yes, that's right, I remember that. And it just, boom, it just hit so hard. As well as just life, you know, it hits so hard. You have more stories to tell, and found that doing this album, there was a very uninterrupted line to, you know, that stuff, and being able to just say, all right, here's my little story I want to tell you about. It goes something like this, and it was very. I found it very easy to do that. Everything about it, you know. There was no struggle, there's no trying to find, like, how should I be singing this? Or anything like that, like, didn't need to do that, I was just, you know what? I'm just gonna do it how I do it. I have a clean, unmetal voice, and that's how I'm gonna sing, that's who I am, and I'm not gonna try and force it to be something it's not. I'm just gonna...
fans enjoy that.
And I think, if anything, it came out better, more authentic.
Yeah, there's some tender moments on there, like, Argentina is our point. It's got some tenderness on there. What about Women Rule the World? I won't ask you to do the vocal part on there, but there's some ridiculous vocals on there.
It's too early, I'm too crusty.
Don't.
It's too broken up, I need to warm up, but all the high.
Where's that all coming from? Not the vocals, I mean literally, lyrically, like what's the story? Tell us about the album, sell
just,
the album.
Just, all right, let's see. Well, that one, just kind of, just laughing at myself, just poking fun at how, you know, we men, we go and pillage and do all these things, and, you know, Ralph Cramden can't get a castle, and but you know, it's all to him, you know.
And I assume in the chorus part of Women Rule the World, you're doing tapping, playing, and singing.
Oh, right? Yeah,
that's
yeah,
a good example of you doing the...
How'd that go? See, after I make an album and I get it all down, it's like I spend so much time on it that I step away and I start to forget everything that I did, and then I have to relearn it all. So that was... But the thing is, like, doing that stuff, you have to sing while you play, so you can't look because you're looking at the audience and singing. So it's like, yeah. Try to act so cool, but you know I'm just a fool for you. I won't
screwed up. Not till I was a doctor to be there with you.
Yeah.
Yeah, some great stuff going on there.
Yeah, I gotta practice that. So yeah, I think there's a lot of things on the album that by itself is like, all right, cool, but to do it together, and that's the thing about it, is that I don't want to say I'm not just a guitar player as if it, you know, minimizes being a guitar player, but mm-hmm. I do more than that. Like, I'm a singer, I've always sang. So I'm a singing guitar player, and for me, if I was to just do one, it would be like playing guitar with just one hand, like you know, it's not fully what you do, yeah. And there's going to be a lot of holes in it. So really, like, if I'm doing something like, you know, doing that, where I'm playing everything together, singing and playing, that's what I do. Mm-hmm. It would be like, you know, if Eddie Van Halen didn't tap, or yeah. You know.
Well, that's plain to hear. Like, you just need to listen to the Barefoot EP, and like Dash is on there, and Simple Days are on there, and actually when you strip them back to just being acoustic songs, they're fantastic songs. It's like singer-songwriter song stuff. Doesn't yeah. need the guitar work there for them to be nice
and
songs.
Really, all the songs, they start off, they all start off in my head, and I have it all arranged. It's like, I know what the cello's gonna do, I got a whole vision in my head, like I could hear it all. And then the first time I really play it is when I get together with Dennis, and we're gonna start laying drums, and then I bring out an acoustic guitar and I just sing it and play it with them, and just, you know, just the strumming gives a sense of yeah. what the groove is, and the feel and the flow and the pace and the everything. Mm-hmm. And we take it and we build it from there. So the song sort of has to stand on its own in a lot of different stages. Like, first it has to work in your head. You have to like what you think, or what you think you hear. You know, if the sound sounds right in between your ears, then you take it out of there, and then you just play it as a song. Just, and if it works like that, good, it's working. Yeah. And there are some songs that don't. Every album has a song, or two, or three, that end up not being finished and mixed and recorded because they just didn't make it past that stage. They just were not. I didn't think they were good enough,
sure.
You know, to give to people. So to try and give the best or the most, yeah. And you know, something. It's like, how do you put it? Like you know, just. I know a lot of women say, you know, whenever you get dressed up to go out, whatever the last thing is you put on, take it off. Which I hope would be their shirt, but no, it's usually just like a bracelet or like some extra accessory or something like that. So it's kind of like, you know, you take that one song that's like, all right, you know what, this one is just too much.
Doesn't
it's not
need
the
to
one,
be there. Yeah.
And
it's there for the sake of being there more than
yeah.
a statement. Okay.
And you end up with a more solid album that way, instead of just giving everything just, you know, just because I wrote it, you know,
yeah.
That doesn't mean that
sure.
it's worthy of sharing with people. Like, you want to have some sort of standard and say, yeah. All right. You know, I'm not going to give people every single thing that I fart out, you know, I just,
yeah,
yeah, there's got to be something at some point where you act like the label or the producer and say, this one just ain't cutting it.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So we talked about kind of songwriting side of things, but there are obviously some pretty crazy guitar moments on the album as well. The fretless solo on Little Brother Is Watching.
Mm-hmm.
Go. Talk to us.
So,
what
yeah,
were you thinking?
Yeah. You know, it just, yeah. So it starts off with just sliding around, sort of pentatonic in different areas. And you want to chirp everything because you want to get those squeaks, those. So start with that. Something like that.
Yeah.
Bring it in. And then just give it a little, a little nod to the melody that the other guitars do. Where you're doing unisons, but
you
don't want them to be perfect,
well.
You want them to clash a little bit. You want those waves to be off so that they get a little bit blurred, a little bit of brrrr. That thing. You want to get that. And then sort of just bouncing off of. Let's get it right. And then when it finishes, you want to chirp it. Where's my chirp? There.
It's in there somewhere.
I can't find my chirp. And then back to... Yeah. So it's just, you know, it's a solo.
Okay.
It's a moment. It's just you know.
Well, so the last song I'll talk about on the album is probably my favourite on the album. I Don't Know Who to Pray To anymore.
Ah, cool.
So where's it coming from? What's the song about? And it's the long one. It's very long, isn't it? Yeah. And there's a hell of a solo on the end of it where you just open up and go for it.
Thanks.
Talk to us about that.
So yeah, that song lyrically is about something that I think most people go through at some point where you just you lose faith because life has just hit you hard and you're angry and you know you need to get past that anger but you just haven't gotten past it yet and just being in that place of that limbo of lost faith, I guess you could say. So it's that kind of thing. Yeah.
And well, if you would be so kind, if I rock the wrist down, would you be okay to solo over that for us? Just a little bit to see what
Yeah, sure.
What you're doing?
Absolutely. So it goes through a lot of different melodies and things like that. And actually, pretty much that end solo, like all the melodies and everything were improvised. Like it was all just scratch track that I threw down and then I was like, all right, let me just play it a little nicer and make sure that it has what it needs. But found that a lot of times the scratch track that you do is going to be your most honest stuff because you're not thinking, you're not saying, okay, this is the album, this is what I got to do, this has to be perfect, it has to be this or whatever. You're just really just doing what you do, and sometimes the most authentic things come out that way.
Let's play it. That was actually quite an honour. I got to play a Bumblefoot song with Bumblefoot.
Sweet! Fun!
That's the album. Little Brother is watching. Well worth checking out. Everybody go check it out. Big fan, and I'm sure you'll enjoy it. But there's lots of other things going on in your career at the moment. You've just started a new band, right?
You mean the Art of Anarchy thing?
Yes.
Ah, yeah, so that... Very interesting. That is... It started in 2011. And it's... These guys that I've been producing their bands and things for about 18 years, we've been friends and been working together. And Yeah, John and Vince Voda, guitar player and a drummer, twin brothers, fun guys, cool guys. So yeah, they started a music company. They wanted the first thing they put out to be the supergroup album, and they had songs written. They just, you know, wanted to make their dream album. So brought him into the studio, started recording everything. I laid down my stuff on there. John Moyer, bass player, came in and just killed it, as always. So then when reaching out to singers, and they reached out to Scott, Scott Weiland, and he did a song, and it was just fantastic what he did. I mean, he took the song to a place that none of us would have thought to take it. And that's what he does. He's phenomenal. I mean, when it comes to melodies and performing them, it's great. Yeah. So yeah, and he did the whole album. So now we have this little supergroup album. You know, everyone came from a different place, came together and all added their things, and no one told anyone, said, no, you can't do that, you can't do this. You know, we just do what you do. And we all did it, and I did the all the production stuff for it. Scott, he recorded his vocals himself and sent them to me. So it should be out around May.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
And that the recordings date back to 2012.
It started in 2011 is when we first started tracking.
Wow.
Yeah.
And then it's been quiet.
Yeah. So it's been over the last few years that all the pieces have been coming together. And last year we did, we shot two videos for it and really nice stuff. I mean, we went big. The helicopter.
Oh, wow.
Circling the, playing on the rooftop and shooting and everything, yeah.
Okay. Sweet. Well, nice. That pretty much sums up the questions I have for you today.
Cool. Now, there's something else that I've been working on, too, that's really interesting, though.
Tell us.
Daryl McDaniels, DMC from Run DMC.
Right.
He's been working with this metal band, Generation Kill, which is a bunch of guys from different bands that have this band. It was the singer of Exodus, Rob Dukes, who's an old friend of mine, and Rob Machete, who's been in a lot of really cool bands. And look at that, I even went like this as I said it. Wow. Yeah, good metal bands. So they have this band, Generation Kill, real badass band. They've been working on this collaboration with DMC, this rap metal thing that's just really nasty.
Wow.
It's good. So Rob reached out to me and said, hey, do you want to produce this thing and do the mixing and add some stuff, add some guitar to it and everything? So now I joined into that, doing that. So we got one song done called Lot Lizard.
Okay.
Nasty fucking song. And I have right now on my laptop two more songs, one called Fired Up and really good stuff. So
sweet.
So hopefully we'll be sharing some of that music soon too.
Well, the last question, the sort of goodbye, is any messages for the audience or anything? You've told us something that we didn't know, which is actually I'm going to consider that an exclusive scoop.
Yeah, it's good stuff. Good stuff.
But any messages for the readers?
Thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. Thank you for playing. Thank you for reading. Thank you for being part of this wonderful guitar world that we're all part of. I've received so much from other guitar players that has inspired me and made me want to pay it forward and share it. And I hope that all of you are getting that same pleasure from all the wonderful guitar players in the world, and that you are paying it forward and sharing it and inspiring others as well, because that's kind of what we all do as guitar players. And I'm really proud to be part of that group that we're all in. So thank you very much. Thank you for including me. Cool, thanks.
Ron, thank you very much for your time today.
No, it was a pleasure.
Looking forward to seeing the clinic and the rest of your UK tour, and hopefully we'll have you back in the magazine again soon.
Oh, hell yeah.
Another album, and yeah, looking forward to it.
Great, thanks.
I've been Levi Clay for Guitar Interactive magazine, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks.